यत्तेहं प्रीयमानाय वक्ष्यामि हितकाम्यजा नमे विदुःसुरगणाः प्रभवं नमहर्षयः अहमादिर्हि देवानां महर्षीणां च सर्वशः यो मामजमनादिं च वेत्ति लोकमहेश्वरम् असम्मूढश्रमत्येषु सर्वपापैः प्रमुच्यते बुद्धिर्ज्ञानमसम्मोहः क्षमा सत्यम् दमः शमः सुखम् दुःखम् भवो भावः भयम् चाभयमेव च अहिंसा समता तुष्टिः तपोदानम् यशो यशः भवन्ति भावा भूतानाम् मर्तयेव पृथग्विधाः महर्षयः सप्त पूर्वे चत्वारो मनवस्तथा मद्भावा मानसा जाताः येषाल्लोक इमाः प्रजाः एताम् विभूतिम् योगम् च मम यो वेत्ति तत्त्वतः सोऽभिकम्पेन योगेन युज्यते नात्र संशयः अहम् सर्वस्य प्रभवः मत्तः सर्वम् प्रवर्तते इति मत्वा भजन्ते माम् बुधाभावसमन्विताः मच्चित्ता मद्गणप्राणाः बोधयन्तः परस्परम् कथयन्तश्च माम् नित्यम् दृश्यन्ति च रमन्ति च तेषाम् सततयुक्तानाम् भजताम् प्रीतिपूर्वकम् ददामि बुद्धियोगम् तम् येन मामुपयान्ति ते तेषामेवानुकम्पार्थम् अहमज्ञानजम् तमः नाशयाम्यात्मभावस्थः ज्ञानदीपेन भास्वता अर्जुन उवाच परम् ब्रह्म परम् धाम पवित्रम् परमम् भवान् पुरुषम् शाश्वतम् दिव्यम् आदिदेवमजम् विभुम् आहुस्त्वा मृषयः सर्वे देवर्षिर्नारदस्तथा असितो देवलो व्यासः स्वयम् चैव ब्रवीषि मे सर्वमेतदृतम् मन्ये यन्माम् वदसि केशव न हि ते भगवन् व्यक्तिम् विदुर्देवानदानवाः स्वयमेवात्मनात्मानम् नेच्छत्वम् पुरुषोत्तम भूतभावनभूतेश देवदेव जगत्पते पक्तुमर्गस्य शेषेण दिव्याख्यात्मविभूतयः याभिर्विभूतिभिर्लोकान् इमाम् सुवम् व्याप्य तिष्ठसि कथम् विद्यामहम् योगिन् त्वाम् सदा परिचिन्तयन् केषु केषु च भावेषु चिन्त्योऽसि भगवन् मया विस्तरेणात्मनो योगम् विभूतिम् च जनार्दन भूयः कथय तृप्तिर्हि शृण्वतो नास्ति मे मृतम् श्रीभगवानुवाच हन्तते कथयिष्यामि दिव्याख्यात्मविभूतयः प्राधान्यतः कुरु श्रेष्ठ नास्त्यन्तो विस्तरस्य मे अहमात्मा गुडाकेश सर्वभूताशयस्थितः अहमादिश्च मध्यम् च भूतानामन्त एव च आदित्यानामहम् विष्णुः ज्योतिषाम् रविरंशुमान् मरीचिर्मरुतामस्मि नक्षत्राणामहम् शशी वेदानाम् सामवेदोऽस्मि देवानामस्मि वासवः इन्द्रियाणाम् मनश्चास्मि भूतानामस्मि चेतना रुद्राणाम् शङ्करश्चास्मि वित्तेशो यक्षरक्षसाम् वसूनाम् पावकश्चास्मि मेरुशिखरिणामहम् पुरोधसाम् च मुख्यम् माम् विद्धि पार्थ बृहस्पतिम् सेनानीनामहम् स्कन्दः सरसामस्मि सागरः महर्षीणाम् ब्रूरहम् विरामस्म्येकमक्षरम् यज्ञानाम् जपयज्ञोऽस्मि स्थावराणाम् हिमालयः अश्वत्थः सर्ववृक्षाणाम् देवऋषीणाम् च नारदः गन्धर्वाणाम् चित्ररथः सिद्धानाम् कपिलो मुनिः उच्चैः शवसमश्वानाम् विद्धि मामृतोद्भवम् ऐरावतम् गजेन्द्राणाम् नराणाम् च नराधिपम् आयुधानामहम् वज्रम् धेनूनामस्मि कामधुक् प्रजनश्चास्मि गन्दर्पः सर्पाणामस्मि वासुकिः अनन्तश्चास्मि नागानाम् वरुणो यादसामहम् पितॄणामर्यमा चास्मि यमः संयमतामहम् प्रह्लादश्चास्मि दैत्यानाम् कालः कलयतामहम् मृगाणाम् च मृगेन्दुरोहम् वैनतेजश्च पक्षिणाम् पवनः पवतामस्मि रामशस्त्रभृतामहम् झषाणाम् मकरश्चास्मि स्रोतसामस्मि जाह्नवी सर्गाणामादिरन्तश्च मध्यम् चैवाहमर्जुन अध्यात्मविद्या विद्यानाम् वादः प्रवदतामहम् अक्षराणामकारोऽस्मि द्वन्द्वः सामासिकस्य च अहमेवाक्षयः कालः धाताहम् विश्वतो मुखः मृत्युः सर्वहरश्चाहम् उद्भवश्च भविष्यताम् कीर्तिश्रीर्वाच्च नारीणाम् स्मृतिर्मेधा धृतिः क्षमा बृहत्साम तथा साम्नाम् गायत्री छन्दसामहम् मासानाम् मार्गशीर्षोऽहम् ऋतूनाम् कुसुमाकरः द्यूतम् चलयतामस्मि तेजस्तेजस्विनामहम् जयोऽस्मि व्यवसायोऽस्मि सत्त्वम् सत्त्ववतामहम् वृष्टीनाम् वासुदेवोऽस्मि पाण्डवानाम् धनञ्जयः मुनीनामप्यहम् व्यासः कवीनामुशना कविः दण्डो दमयतामस्मि नीतिरस्मि जिगीषताम् मौनम् चैवास्मि गुह्यानाम् ज्ञानम् ज्ञानवतामहम् यच्चापि सर्वभूतानाम् बीजम् तदहमर्जुन नरस्ति विना यस्यात् मया भूतम् चराचरम् नान्तोऽस्मि मम दिव्यानाम् विभूतीनाम् परन्तप येष तु उद्देशतः प्रोक्तः भूतेर्विस्तरो मया यद्यद्विभूतिमत्सत्त्वम् श्रीमदूर्जितमेव वा तत्तदेवावगच्छत्वम् मम तेजोऽंशसम्भवम् अथवा बहुनैतेन किम् ज्ञातेन तवार्जुन विष्टभ्याहमिदम् कृत्स्नम् एकांशेन स्थितो जगत् ॐ तत्सत् इति श्रीमद्भगवद्गीतासु उपनिषत्सु ब्रह्मविद्यायाम् योगशास्त्रे श्रीकृष्णार्जुनसंवादे विभूतियोगो नाम दशमोऽध्यायः। अथ दशमोऽध्यायः। श्रीभगवानुवाच भूयदेव महाबाहो शृणु मे परमम् वचः यत्तेऽहम् प्रीयमानाय वक्ष्यामि हितकाम्यया न मे विदुःसुरगणाः प्रभवम् न महर्षयः अहमादिर्हि देवानाम् महर्षीणाम् च सर्वशः यो मामजमनादिम् च वेत्ति लोकमहेश्वरम् असम्मूढस्रमत्येषु सर्वपापैः प्रमुच्यते बुद्धिर्ज्ञानमसम्मोहः क्षमा सत्यम् दमश्यमः सुखम् दुःखम् भवो भावः भयम् चाभयमेव च अहिंसा समता तुष्टिः तपोदानम् यशो यशः भवन्ति भावा भूतानाम् मत्तयेव पृथग्विधाः महर्षयः सप्त पूर्वे चत्वारो मनवस्तथा मद्भावा मानसा जाताः येषाल्लोक इमाः प्रजाः एताम् विभूतिम् योगम् च मम यो वेत्ति तत्त्वतः सोऽविकम्पेन योगेन युज्यते नात्र संशयः अहम् सर्वस्य प्रभवः मत्तः सर्वम् प्रवर्तते इति मत्वा भजन्ते माम् बुधाभावसमन्विताः मच्चित्ता मद्गणप्राणाः बोधयन्तः परस्परम् कथयन्तश्च माम् नित्यम् तुष्यन्ति च रमन्ति च तेषाम् सततयुक्तानाम् भजताम् प्रीतिपूर्वकम् ददामि बुद्धियोगम् तम् येन मामुपयान्ति ते तेषामेवानुकम्पार्थम् अहमज्ञानजम् तमः नाशयाम्यात्मभावस्थः ज्ञानदीपेन भास्वता। अर्जुन उवाच परम् ब्रह्म परम् धाम पवित्रम् परमम् भवान् पुरुषम् शाश्वतम् दिव्यम् आदिदेवमजम् विभुम् आहुस्त्वामृषयः सर्वे देवर्षिर्नारदस्तथा असितो देवलो व्यासः स्वयम् चैव ब्रवीषि मे सर्वमेतदृतम् मन्ये यन्माम् वदसि केशव न हि ते भगवन् व्यक्तिम् विदुर्देवानदानवाः स्वयमेवात्मनात्मानम् नेच्छत्वम् पुरुषोत्तम भूतभावनभूतेश देवदेव जगत्पते पक्तुमर्गस्य शेषेण दिव्याट्यात्मविभूतयः या विभूतिभिर्लोकान् इमां सुवं व्याप्य तिष्ठसि कथं विद्यामहं योगिन् त्वां सदा परिचिन्तयन् केषु केषु च भावेषु चिन्त्योऽसि भगवन् मया विस्तरेणात्मनो योगम् विभूतिम् च जनार्दन भूयः कथय तृप्तिर्हि शृण्वतो नास्ति मे मृतम् श्रीभगवानुवाच हन्तते कथयिष्यामि दिव्याह्यात्मविभूतयः प्राधान्यतः कुरु श्रेष्ठ नास्त्यन्तो विस्तरस्य मे अहमात्मा गुडाकेश सर्वभूताशयस्थितः अहमादिश्च मध्यम् च भूतानामन्त एव च आदित्यानामहम् विष्णुः ज्योतिषाम् रविरंशुमान् मरीचिर्मरुतामस्मि नक्षत्राणामहम् शशी वेदानाम् सामवेदोऽस्मि देवानामस्मि वासवः इन्द्रियाणाम् मनश्चास्मि भूतानामस्मि चेतना रुद्राणाम् शङ्करश्चास्मि वित्तेशो यक्षरक्षसा वसूनाम् पावकश्चास्मि मेरुशिखरिणामहम् पुरोधसाम् च मुख्यम् माम् विद्धि पार्थ बृहस्पतिम् सेनानीनामहम् स्कन्दः सरसामस्मि सागरः महर्षीणाम् भ्रुगुरहम् गिरामस्म्येकमक्षरम् यज्ञानाम् जपयज्ञोऽस्मि स्थावराणाम् हिमालयः अश्वत्थः सर्ववृक्षाणाम् देवऋषीणाम् च नारदः गन्धर्वाणाम् चित्ररथः सिद्धानाम् कपिलो मुनिः उच्चैः शमसमश्वानाम् विद्धि मामृतोद्भवम् ऐरावतम् गजेन्द्राणाम् नराणाम् च नराधिपम् आयुधानामहम् वज्रम् धेनूनामस्मि कामधुक् व्रजनश्चास्मि गन्धर्पः सर्पाणामस्मि वासुकिः अनन्त
पृथिवी शान्तिरन्तरिक्षगं शान्तिर् द्यौ शान्तिर्दिश शान्तिरवान्तर दिशा शान्तिरग्निःशान्तिर्वायुः शान्तिरादित्यः शान्तिश्चन्द्रमा शान्तिर्नक्षत्राणि शान्तिरापः शान्तिरोषधय शान्तिर्वनस्पतयः शान्तिर्गौ शान्तिरजा शान्तिरश्वः शान्तिः पुरुषः शान्तिर्ब्रह्म शान्तिर्ब्राह्मणः शान्तिः शान्तिरेव शान्तिः शान्तिर्मे अस्तु शान्तिः
मे दे बी पीस् आन् अर्थ् एण्ड् इन् द स्काय् मे दे बी पीस् इन् द वाटर् एण्ड् इन् आल् डिरेक्षन्स् मे दे बी पीस् इन् द प्लाण्ट्स् इन् द ट्रीस् एण्ड् इन् एनिमल्स् May there be peace in the hearts of all beings. May there be peace in everyone and in everything.
Sarvetra sukhinas santu, sarve santu niramayaha, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kaschit dukkha bhag bhavet, sarvastaratu durgani, सर्वो भद्राणि पश्यतु सर्वः सद्बुद्धिमाप्नोतु सर्वः सर्वत्र नन्दतु
मे आल् बी हेप्पी एण्ड् हेल्ति मे आल् सी वट् इस् गुड् एण्ड् मे नो वन् experience misery. May all overcome their obstacles and acquire good tendencies. May people everywhere find joy and fulfillment. Let us now spend some time touching the center of peace and joy in our hearts. A good way to begin the practice is to withdraw the scattered energies of the mind and bring them to rest on one point. That point can be our own breathing. Let us therefore practice breathing with awareness. As we breathe in, let us visualize that our body and mind are being filled with love, strength, and compassion. And as we breathe out, let us release all the stress, anxiety, and exhaustion in the body and mind. Let us practice this way for a while. Let us now turn our attention to the region of our heart. Although God is present everywhere and in everyone, the divine presence can be felt most clearly in our own hearts. We can meditate in any way we have been taught. To remain focused, we can take the help of a short mental prayer or a mantra or a divine name. Let us now spend some time dwelling on the presence of God in our hearts. Om Asatoma Satkamayam Tamasoma Jyotirgamayam Mrityorma Amrutam Gamayam Aviravir Mayethi Rudrayate Dakshinam Mukham Tenamam Pahi Nityam. May the Divine lead us from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. May the divine consciousness fill our hearts and protect us. Good morning, nice, bright, sunny morning here in Kenmore Square area and Boston area, and I imagine in most parts of New England. And those of you who are streaming in from distant places, I hope the weather in your place is good also, especially our friends and people in Texas and that part of the country in the last few days have been extremely difficult, but I hear that things are improving gradually in those places as well. Last week we concluded with an important verse, which the last verse in chapter 9. Please take a look, that's verse 34 in chapter 9. It goes like this. Manmana bhavamat bhakto madhya jhimam namaskuru mame vaishyasi yuktvaivam atmanam matparayanaha. Fill thy mind with me, be my devotee, sacrifice unto me, bow down to me, thus having made thy heart steadfast in me, taking me as the supreme goal, thou shalt come to me. Now, all of this makes sense to a devotee. All of this makes sense to someone who takes their spiritual life seriously. Of course, if we want to lead a spiritual life, we must have a spiritual ideal. And in theistic terms, that usually means by this generic word that we all use, God. That we must always fill our mind with God, think of God, do everything with God in mind. Now, all of this makes sense. The difficulty becomes that the term God, or whatever or whoever we understand by God, is often too abstract. So what does it mean to pray to God always? I just received an email a few days ago from someone who recognized the importance of praying, who was very devoted, but said that when I sit down to pray, I really do not know how to do it. How to pray? What do I exactly do? And that inability to know what to pray for, how to do it, how to make prayer a meaningful activity, is directly connected with our understanding or our lack of understanding of who we are praying to. So, while praying to God makes complete sense, all of these terms become challenging when we actually start doing it. And that's why Swami Vivekananda said an ounce of practice is worth tons of theory. A lot of times when we read something, we feel that, oh, I have understood it now, this makes sense. But then when we try to actually put it into practice, we suddenly recognize that what we thought we had understood, we may not have understood it in depth. And God is one such entity or reality or a being who remains abstract for many people. And if that is the case for us, we don't have to feel discouraged, because God is a being who is so transcendent, who is so beyond the grasp of our senses and our mind, that it is difficult to know exactly who God is. That is what Krishna describes in verse 2 of chapter 10.
Name vidusuraganaha prabhavam namaharshayaha ahamadirhite vanam maharshinam cha sarvashah.
He says, neither the hosts of devas, nor the great rishis, nor my know my origin, for in every way I am the source of all the devas and the great rishis. So because God is the source of all of us, none of us were there in the beginning. So God has always been there. It's a little bit like if we have never asked our parents anything about their life before we were born, we wouldn't know anything. We would just think, well, they are our parents. But just as we get to know them better, know them more, when we recognize that my dad was also once a little boy, my mom was also once a little girl. So once we get to know about our parents before they became parents, who they were, what they were, where they were, we have a better understanding, a better knowledge of them as important presence in our lives. Now, God is an important presence in our lives, but we don't have any information about God other than God is God. And that's why Krishna says that God is the source of all. Therefore, everything and everyone in the universe has come into being after God. And therefore, it's very difficult for them to know God in God's entirety. And then he describes a way. Again, it's still a bit abstract, but take a look at it. Verse number 3. Yo mam ajam anadincha veti loka maheshwaram asammoodhas samartyeshu sarva papaiv pramuchyate. He who knows me birthless and deathless, birthless and beginningless, the great Lord of worlds, he among mortals is undeluded. He is freed from all sins. So we have given a little clue that God is birthless. There was never a time when God did not exist. So God has always been there. It wasn't as if God was born at some point in history. And beginningless, well, God didn't have a beginning. Which is assuring, because everything that has a beginning has an end. And God did not have a beginning, so God doesn't have an end. God was never born, so God will never die. Still fairly abstract, but we have some clue that the being we are praying to, the being we worship, the being we adore, the being who is the source of everyone and everything, he's always been there, well, unborn and beginningless. And then the next two verses will give more clues about God being present in everything in this universe. Everything that is tangible, everything that is intangible, in every idea, in every feeling. There is a portion in the Taittiriya Upanishad where it is said, Tat srishtva tadeva anupravishata. Tat srishtva, srishti. Having projected this entire universe, tadeva anupravishata, the infinite being entered into every tiny bit of it. Now we can still keep on asking questions. How did the infinite being enter into every particle of everything? How could the infinite fit into the finite? These are the kind of questions that can come. But we read in the Upanishad, this is exactly what happened. In other words, everything and everyone we encounter in this world is filled with the divine, because that is what the Vedas say. So every object in this universe, every living and non-living entity in this universe is a way the divine is manifesting. And that is what it described in verse number 7. Take a look at it. Etam vibhutim yogancha मम यो वेत्ति तत्त्वतः सोविकम्पेन योगेन युज्यते नात्र संशयः.
He who in reality knows these manifestations of my being and this yoga power of mine becomes established on the unshakable yoga. There is no doubt about it. So, if it is difficult to know God as God is, because God was there way before any of us were, then another way to try to understand the divine is to see and feel the presence of the divine in all of these different manifestations. And one who is able to do it becomes established in what Krishna says, the unshakable yoga. Avikampena yogena, the yoga, that firmness, that stability. Right now, it's not as if we don't feel our connection with God, but it is not unshakable. There are times when our faith wavers. There are times when God seems to disappear from our mental horizon. And there are times when God appears. There are times when we are able to feel the presence of God. So there is this continuous hide and seek that is going on. Now all of this hide and seek will end when we get this unshakable yoga, when we become firmly established in the awareness of the divine outside us and within us. Look at verse 8.
Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattas sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante mam buddha bhava samanvitaha.
I am the origin of all. From me everything evolves. Thus thinking, the wise worship me with loving consciousness. This is important. I am the origin of all. This we can understand in one sense. Well, we have all come from the divine being. But Krishna is saying here is that the origin of everything that we see around us, but everything that seems to be a product of my effort, my thinking, is also not really mine, because God is the origin of all. Now, in today's world, we might still claim copyrights, that this is my idea, or this is a product I invented, or this is a discovery I made. And maybe in this relative world, that kind of claim might have some role. But a devotee, one who is aware of the divine presence, even when such things are said or claimed, that this is my idea, this is my work, this is something I did, should in their heart remember this verse. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattas sarvam pravartate. Everything has come from the divine. So even the most brilliant idea that I have, for which I want recognition, to a devotee will say, even that idea came through God's grace. And really, it was the origin of that idea was God's. So if any recognition should be received, God should get that recognition. Now, of course, you don't have to go on telling other people, oh, God did it, not I. I mean, if they are devotees also, they might understand, but they might just smile and say, we know this already. And if those people are not spiritually oriented, you were telling everyone, I didn't do it, God did it, might become an object of ridicule in an increasingly secular environment of today. So you don't have to say this aloud, but for all the achievements that we have in this life, all the recognition that we get, even if people heap all that praise and award and recognition to us, a devotee will say in the heart, kind of redirect it or forward it, that all this recognition and praise really belongs to God because everything came from God. By this way of redirecting all the recognition and praise for things that were achieved, things that were done, first of all, the devotee is doing the right thing. But secondly, it's also a protection. Because all of the things that produce pain and suffering in life, ego, pride, and when that pride is hurt, anger, jealousy, envy, all of these negativities, which are the primary cause of pain and suffering in life, all of these things can be removed or at least minimized if we learn to redirect all the praise and recognition to the divine. And it's completely an internal process. So this verse is very important, can be kept in mind. The 8th verse in the 10th chapter, where Krishna says, God is the origin of all, and everything evolves from God. Everything comes from God. Verse 9.
Machitta madgata prana bodhayanta parasparam kathayantashchamam nityam tushyanti charamanti cha.
This is an echo, or almost a repetition, you could say, of the last verse of chapter 9 that we saw in the beginning.
With their minds wholly in me, with their senses absorbed in me, enlightening one another and always speaking of me, they are satisfied and delighted.
Now, verse 10. This is a very important verse also. There's an important word here, important phrase that's what Sri Krishna uses, which we need to reflect on a little bit. So let me read the verse first.
Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenama mupayantite.
To them ever steadfast and serving me with affection, I give that buddhi yoga by which they come unto me. So those spiritual seekers who try to build their life around the divine, recognizing that God is the source of everything, that everything comes from God, that nothing is mine, that everything is God's. Those who, as the previous verse said, their minds wholly in God, with their senses absorbed in God, such are the people. To such people, satata yukta nam. Satata yukta means people who are continuously connected with the divine. Yoga, to be joining, to be connected. Satata yukta, satata means always. Satata yukta nam, to such people, and who serve the divine with affection. So everything that they do in life is done with the spirit of service, and service is a form of worship. In fact, all of the worship that is done, it is a way of serving the divine. And those of you who have been attending the pujas, the worships at the Vedanta Society, know this very well, that the puja that we do, the puja that is dedicated to the different forms of the divine, whether it is Shiva or the goddess Durga or Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, and so on. Now, all of these different ways the divine manifests in life, the puja is a way of inviting the divine in some form or in some way to our own place of residence. If you're doing puja at home, you're inviting the divine at your home. If a puja is done in a place of worship like the Vedanta Center, then we are inviting the divine collectively, as a group, as a community. We're inviting the divine in a special way, and then we offer service. And in a ritualistic form of worship, that service is offered through offering of flowers and sandal paste, incense, fruits, sweets, and food, and so on. But the same divine, when we try to see the divine in a person before me and try to serve that person, recognizing the presence of the divine in the heart of that person, then that service also becomes a form of worship. So this service, that's what the meaning here, bhajatam priti purvakam, those who serve the divine with that love, with that devotion, with that affection, to such people I give the buddhi yoga. So I give them buddhi yoga by which they come to me. So this word buddhi yoga is an interesting word. A lot has been discussed about this in different books. Buddhi, one way of understanding buddhi in the context here, the buddhi sometimes just get translated as an intellect, and that is true. And in that sense, we could say every one of us has buddhi. We all have intellect. Now, all the intellects may not be developed to the same extent, just like a flower. Not all flowers bloom fully. Some are half-bloomed, some have not yet opened their petals. So buddhi is there in all of us. So one way of understanding that is that a full opening up of the buddhi, when the flower is fully bloomed, all the petals have fully opened out, that would be the full blossoming of the intellect. Or we could say that enough of our intellect has opened up for us to take care of our duties and responsibilities in this world in which we live and move and operate. But to a spiritual seeker, we are seeking entry into a larger world, into a more subtle world, into a world that is not simply a world of atoms and molecules, a world that is in some sense beyond the senses. So can my intellect give me a grasp of the world which is beyond the senses? Our present state of the intellect is such that it does depend on the senses. We can have a lot of intellectualizing of things, but we need data. We need information. What the intellect does is take this data and use it in different combinations and then come up with different insights. But without enough information, the intellect has nothing to play with, nothing to analyze, nothing to work with. And so at present, our intellect, even a person who may have received Nobel Prize, even a person who is considered a genius, and clearly that intellect has opened up considerably, but even that intellect depends on certain information which comes through mind and the senses in order to come up with amazing insights. Now, what about things that are beyond the scope of the mind and beyond the scope of the senses? Because that is what the Vedas say, that this spiritual world is avang manasa gocharam. There the mind cannot go, the senses cannot go. So how can the intellect, how can the buddhi operate when there is no data forthcoming? Which gives us a way to imagine that maybe my present buddhi hasn't opened up fully yet. Maybe the buddhi has a higher dimension. And that higher dimension of buddhi would give me access to those, to that realm which my present buddhi has no access to. So the word that is used oftentimes in these texts is the word dhi or the word medha for that higher form of buddhi which can provide me an entry into a world beyond the mind, beyond the senses. That is the same dhi that we pray for in that great Gayatri prayer. Those of you who are familiar with that prayer, you know that it ends with dhiyo yonaf prachodayat. Dhiyaha, it's in the plural there, means may this dhi guide our understanding. May this dhi direct our understanding. Sometimes, therefore, the word dhi is translated as the power of spiritual intuition, because it's not just an ordinary intellect, it's intuition. Now, the word intuition is a little tricky. It's something that we need to be also careful about, because we tend to use that word sometimes in our daily life, that something that cannot be reasoned out, and we say, oh, I have an intuition, it's like this. Sometimes that intuition may be right, sometimes it may be totally wrong. And so we have to be careful with all these intuitions that we get in daily life. So long as these intuitions are dealing only with our own selves, it's up to us whether to believe these intuitions or not. But if we have some intuitions which involve other people or things beyond our circle, then we have to be even more careful. Otherwise, there's going to be chaos. It's like some person might say, my intuition is now if I go and slap you, that's good for you. But that may not be the intuition of the person who's going to receive a slap from you. This was an absolutely very, very crude and childish example, I know that. But we do sometimes use our intuitions to do things that involve other people. And so I'm just striking a note of caution here. But the intuition, that's why I'm a little hesitant to use the word intuition. That's why it often gets qualified by the adjective spiritual intuition. Again, simply giving it a name doesn't really necessarily mean that we have made that concept any clearer. Sometimes we see that the mind or the knowledge that the mind gets or the state of the mind gets classified as something that is the mind as an unconscious state, the conscious state. And we know the meaning of it in a general way, that now the mind is very conscious because we are aware of everything that is happening around us. When we go to sleep, the mind is no longer conscious of this waking world, but it becomes conscious of another world that we create, the dream world. That's what the mind becomes conscious of. Then when we are in a state of deep sleep, the mind is not conscious of the waking world or the dream world. It just becomes conscious of just nothing. But it's conscious. It's conscious of not knowing anything. It's conscious of the rest that it is getting, which is why when we wake up next morning, and if you have had a really deep sleep, we say, oh, I slept so well. I didn't know anything at all. There was this storm at night. I had no idea. And now I feel really great. I was very happy in that state of deep sleep. So we did. We were conscious of not knowing anything, and we were conscious of the wonderful feeling we had, which is what we are recognizing and when we say these things the next morning. So we understand what it means to be conscious and what it means to be unconscious at least partially unconscious of some of the things in life. But there is a third state that is sometimes referred to as superconscious. That is conscious of something, but that consciousness doesn't come or is not mediated through the mind and the senses. So all of these visions that the mystics have, all of the great things that spiritual seekers see in a state of samadhi, in a state of deep meditation, all of those things are sometimes said to have occurred in a state of superconsciousness. So we have all these different words that are used, whether it's superconscious or through awakening the power of spiritual intuition. All of these things are included in this word buddhi yoga. In other words, the more I become aware of the presence of the divine everywhere and in everyone, and if I continue to serve that divine in different ways, that's why it says satata yuktanam, continuously serving it, then that power of spiritual intuition, that buddhi, that ability to see these things clearly will be awakened in me. So, before this power is awakened in me, I will have to make an effort to see God everywhere. Even when I'm not actually seeing God everywhere, I'm making an effort to see God. And if that effort is done with faith, that is where Shraddha, that deep faith comes in. If it is done with faith, with love, with devotion, it is then that that power is awakened. And that is what is called buddhi yoga. Look at the next verse, immediately after that, verse 11. Teshameva anukampartham aham ajnanajam tamaha nashayami atmabhavastho jnana deepena bhasvata. Out of mere compassion for them, I, abiding in their hearts, destroy the darkness in them, born of ignorance, by the luminous lamp of knowledge. The word is beautiful word here. Jnana deepa. The lamp of knowledge, the lamp of awareness. The Buddha used a similar word, meaning the same thing. He used the word atmadipo bhava, be the lamp of the self, be a lamp unto yourself. So the self here, the real self, the true self, is pure awareness. So the idea is the same, whether you call it jnana deepa, call it atmadipa. So it is this light of the self that will dispel all ignorance. And that is what the divine will do. So now we have a little bit of a clear picture about the methodology. That yes, the divine is abstract. The divine is beyond the reach of the senses. Even those in the celestial world, even the great sages, everyone has that difficulty, not in talking about the divine, well, we are doing it right now, not in creating a conceptual framework, not in creating ideas about the divine. Again, ideas are a little bit easier to hold on to. But the divine, it's in as a divine, the truth of the divine, the reality of the divine, the divine itself, the word itself, I'm a little hesitant, to the divine, to grasp the divine is more difficult than grasping the idea of the divine. And this is again important thing to remember, is that all of the arguments, all of the debates, all of the differences that we notice in the world related to spiritual life are about ideas. So ideas about God. And clearly there are many different ideas, which is what we say, how Hindus see God, or how Muslims view, what is Muslim idea of God, or how Christians or Catholics and Protestants and Jewish people and Buddhists, how do they see the divine? So ideas can be very different, at least appear to be different. Usually they are not completely different. There are some overlaps, but there are certain specificities in which they look very different. But it's good to remember that the differences are in the ideas. The Gita's approach is that God is one, God is the same person. But my idea of God, your idea of God, and someone else's idea of God, the ideas could be many, ideas could be different. The only way, and we can really keep on endlessly debating, talking, and fighting about these ideas. But the only way to put it all to an end is to actually see God. So religion is not simply about believing in certain things or reading certain books or arguing about these ideas. Religion means seeing. That is why we see in the teachings of Ramakrishna and Holy Mother and Swamiji, they keep on emphasizing that religion is realization. Religion is not merely just acknowledging something or believing in something or having faith in something. Yes, faith is important. Every spiritual quest begins with faith. But at some point, that faith must mature into direct experience. Because it is experience that will liberate us. That faith, we can no longer depend on faith all the time. Faith is important, but faith must make way for direct experience at some point. That's the idea. So Buddhi Yoga is really what brings about that transition. Buddhi Yoga is what makes it possible for faith to be transformed into experience. So until that Buddhi, until that power of spiritual intuition opens up, until we begin to see God, till that time we need to have this deep faith in the existence of God. Once we see God, faith becomes a little superfluous. I no longer have to say I have faith in God when you have actually been in the presence of the divine. And that is what Krishna says is possible. Now obviously, hearing Krishna say this, Arjuna wants to know. I would like to then, of course, I mean, who wouldn't want? If we were in, and Arjuna is really speaking on behalf of all of us. Arjuna is saying, oh, do tell me then. The next few verses they will see that Arjuna says, I would like to see you. And recognizing that at present my inability to see you as you are, let me begin to see you by the way you manifest yourself in everything and everyone. And the word for manifestation used in this chapter is called Vibhuti. There's this entire 10th chapter, therefore, is called a Vibhuti Yoga, the manifestation of the divine. Because if I see the manifestation, it will become easier for me then to see the divine at some point. Because the manifestations are easier to grasp, easier to see than the source from which that manifestation has come. And so the rest of the chapter is Krishna telling Arjuna what are the different ways in which the divine manifests. Now, that's a tall order because God has entered into every little thing in this universe. Now, if you have to enumerate or list, the Gita would have been much bigger. It's like billions and trillions and gazillion things God would say, this is how I manifest. I manifested this, I manifested this, I manifested that. And so what Krishna is doing here is says, let me just give you a sampling. Let me just give you a few representative objects which can be seen as my manifestations. And therefore then you will see that things like, who am I among the priests? Who am I among the oceans and the rishis and among horses and so on. So among animals, among objects, among things in this world, in the things in the other world, you'll find a big long list. And sometimes some scholars and some commentators have gone into analysis of every little thing that Krishna mentions here and saying why Krishna chose this manifestation and not something else. And that's an interesting study in itself. And those of you who are interested can look at those commentaries where there's a description given about why Krishna chose one sample and not the other. But the point is really is not about saying, because Krishna in the end will say that the divine is present in everything, not just in the things that are mentioned here, but these are just a sampling. So what do we as devotees, as spiritual seekers, learn from this? One thing is the paradox itself, that God is present in everyone and in everything. And most of us, when we begin our spiritual life, we find it difficult to see God in anyone and in anything. So that's the first paradox, that someone who is everywhere and in everyone, we don't see that someone anywhere and in anyone. And so the sensible thing, it seems to me, is to begin by trying to see God somewhere, in someone, in something. Can I see God at least in one being, at least in one place? Because if I cannot see God even in any one form or in any one place, what hope have I of seeing God in every person, in every being, and in every place? As they say, I think it's a Chinese proverb which says, even the journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. So no matter how long or how far I want to go, it always begins with the first step. So if I want to see God everywhere and in everyone, if I want to feel the presence of the divine in everyone, the first step, the first thing would be, let me try to see if I can see God in one being, in one place, or in one thing, in one symbol. So in that being, that form, becomes our own, the first form, or the first place, or the first being, in which there's a natural response from the body and mind and says, yes, when I look at this being, this form, I'm reminded of God, I'm reminded of the divine. Then that becomes our chosen way of connecting ourselves with the divine. And so that chosen form, that chosen object of our adoration is, in Sanskrit, they call it Ishta. And oftentimes that becomes our entry point into the spiritual world. That chosen ideal that we have is tangible. It's not abstract. And therefore, it's easier to meditate on that ideal. It's easier to adore that ideal. It's easier to worship that ideal. So the chosen form, the first form in which we get the feeling, the sense, the conviction, the faith that, yes, this connects me. This is the window through which I feel connection with the divine. That is when this buddhi, the buddhi yoga, is beginning to take roots in our heart. And once we are able to see the divine in one being, oftentimes our ishta, then there is hope. Because if I see it in one being, then maybe if I try harder, and be able to see it in 2, maybe in 20, in 30. That's how we begin. And so it's interesting that God is everywhere, but in order to see God everywhere, I have to start somewhere. And because people are different, because not all of us think exactly in the same way, not all of us feel exactly in the same way, not all of us respond to everything in the same way, it's natural that that entry point into spiritual life will not be same for everyone. And that's wonderful that we have this choice. If God were to say, this is the only form I manifest in, then I think that would be problematic, because people are different. To some people, that one form in which the divine manifests might resonate, and to some other people, it might leave them cold. It's like, no. And then they might have no hope, no choice. But now God is present in these infinite manifestations, and so there is a chance for every one of us, no matter how much different our way of thinking is, we'll always find some ideal, some symbol, some form, some way the divine has been perceived in the past or has been encountered in the past. Some of these things will suddenly make some, you just feel something here and say, yes, this is how I think of God. And the beauty is this: once I establish that connection with that one manifestation, that one vibhuti of the divine, that vibhuti becomes a window. And through that vibhuti, it becomes easier then to begin to see the same light, the same effulgence, the same lamp of knowledge, jnana deepa, as this verse points out, that same lamp shining in all these different forms throughout this universe. And so this Vibhuti Yoga, the 10th chapter of the Gita, is very interesting, very fascinating, especially because of this Buddhi Yoga. It shows us that once all that I need is to open up that power, that dhi in the Gayatri Prayer, dhiyo yonah prachodayat. Once my buddhi becomes purified, it will be able to see and feel and adore the presence of the divine in one manifestation, and through that one manifestation into many countless infinite other manifestations. So how do we then awaken that buddhi? It's not complicated at all. It's pretty straightforward and simple. I just have to hold on to the path of dharma. Sri Ramakrishna says, truthfulness is the austerity for the times in which we live. So if someone holds on to the path of truth, someone holds on to the ideal of being honest, unselfish, loving, kind, cultivating these positive virtues in spiritual life and working to eliminate all the negativities of the heart. The anger, hatred, jealousy, all of these things which make the heart heavy, which brings so much pain and suffering. So if I eliminate all these weaknesses and constantly strive to cultivate these strengths, this is the way for that buddhi to awaken. So this higher power of spiritual intuition is already present in us. It's not going to come flying from somewhere else. It's already in our heart, but it's kind of remaining in a latent way. It's sleeping. It needs to be awakened. And to awaken it, we must have a strong foundation of moral and ethical living. Because without that strong foundation, this dhi can never be awakened. So that's essentially it. It does, yes, it happens through God's grace, but God's grace comes when we strive to live honestly, truthfully, doing all the right things and consciously avoiding things that make us forget God. And the strength to live that way will also come through God's grace. So there is self-effort involved. But the more we make an effort ourselves, slowly and steadily, the devotee realizes that even that effort I would not have been able to do without God's grace. In fact, I've quoted this verse before. There is a book called Avadhuta Gita, and there is a verse which says, Ishvara anugrahadeva pumsam advaita vasana. A lot of time people think, oh, non-duality, advaita, it doesn't have to deal with God and all this kind of thing. That book is an uncompromising text dealing with non-duality, with advaita. And it has this very enigmatic verse in the beginning which says, even the desire for advaita, even the desire for non-duality comes through God's grace. Go figure that out, what it means. So once, that's the attitude of a spiritual seeker. This I has to completely go. If I think, oh, I have done it on with my own effort. I did so much meditation, I did so much prayer, and that is why God came to me. Forget it. It's never going to happen. Our efforts are never going to be enough. But we need to make that effort to realize that it's not going to be enough. And when we do have that vision, when that heart, when it does open, when we do experience the divine, no true spiritual seeker will say, I did it through my own effort. If anyone says that, oh, I have realized God and I worked it on my effort, I can tell you that person hasn't realized God. Or if someone says, I've seen the divine because I worked very hard for it, person has not seen the divine. Because if you have truly experienced the presence of God, you will never feel that you got it out of your own effort or that you worked hard for it. Because that I has to go, I has to disappear before that vision occurs. And when that I disappears, all that remains is God's grace. So I encourage you to read this chapter 10 later on and see the different manifestations of the divine and see that which of these manifestations naturally ring a bell in your heart and says, yes, I feel connected to the divine when I think of God in this way, or in this form, or in this symbol. And holding on to that, our own chosen, favored way of looking at the divine, we can hold on to that, we can meditate on it, we can pray to it, and then that through that window, we have an entry into this infinite world of spirituality. So we will stop here now. We'll take a 5-minute break. And if you have any comments, questions, thoughts, please put them in the comment section. And then we'll try to take a look at some of them. So a 5-minute break now.
तपोदानं यशो यशः भवन्ति भावा भूतानां मत्तये
महर्षयः सप्त पूर्वे चत्वारो मनवस्तथा मद्भावा मानसा जाताः येषां लोक इमाः प्रजाः एतां विभूतिं योगं च मम यो वेत्ति तत्त्वतः सोऽभिकम्पेन योगेन युज्यते नात्र संशयः अहं सर्वस्य प्रभवः मत्तः सर्वं प्रवर्तते इति मत्वा भजन्ते माम् बुधा भावसमन्विताः मच्चित्ता मद्गणप्राणाः बोधयन्तः परस्परम् कथयन्तश्च माम् नित्यम् तुष्यन्ति च रमन्ति च तेषाम् सततयुक्तानाम् भजताम् प्रीतिपूर्वकम् ददामि बुद्धियोगम् तम् येन मामुपयान्ति ते तेषामेवानुकम्पार्थम् अहमज्ञानजम् तमः नाशयाम्यात्मभावस्थः ज्ञानदीपेन भास्वता अर्जुन उवाच परम् ब्रह्म परम् धाम पवित्रम् परमम् भवान् पुरुषम् शाश्वतम् दिव्यम् आदिदेवमजम् विभुम् आहुस्त्वा मृषयः सर्वे देवर्षिर्नारदस्तथा असितो देवलो व्यासः स्वयम् चैव ब्रवीषि मे सर्वमेतदृतम् मन्ये यन्माम् वदसि केशव न हि ते भगवन् व्यक्तिम् विदुर्देवानदानवाः स्वयमेवात्मनात्मानम् नेच्छत्वम् पुरुषोत्तम भूतभावनभूतेश देवदेव जगत्पते पक्तुमर्हस्य शेषेण दिव्याख्यात्मविभूतयः याभिर्विभूतिभिर्लोकान् इमाम् सुवम् व्याप्य तिष्ठसि कथम् विद्यामहम् योगिन् त्वाम् सदा परिचिन्तयन् केषु केषु च भावेषु चिन्त्योऽसि भगवन् मया विस्तरेणात्मनो योगम् विभूतिम् च जनार्दन भूयः कथय तृप्तिर्हि शृण्वतो नास्ति मे मृतम् श्रीभगवानुवाच हन्तते कथयिष्यामि दिव्याख्यात्मविभूतयः प्राधान्यतः कुरु श्रेष्ठ नास्त्यन्तो विस्तरस्य मे अहमात्मा गुडाकेश सर्वभूताशयस्थितः अहमादिश्च मध्यम् च भूतानामन्त एव च आदित्यानामहम् विष्णुः ज्योतिषाम् रविरंशुमान् मरीचिर्मरुतामस्मि नक्षत्राणामहम् शशी वेदानाम् सामवेदोऽस्मि देवानामस्मि वासवः इन्द्रियाणाम् मनश्चास्मि भूतानामस्मि चेतना रुद्राणाम् शङ्करश्चास्मि नित्येशो यक्षरक्षसाम् वसूनाम् पावकश्चास्मि मेरुशिखरिणामहम् पुरोधसाम् च मुख्यम् माम् विद्धि पार्थ बृहस्पतिम् सेनानीनामहम् स्कन्दः सरसामस्मि सागरः महर्षीणाम् भ्रुरहम् विरामस्म्येकमक्षरम् यज्ञानाम् जपयज्ञोऽस्मि स्थावराणाम् हिमालयः अश्वत्थः सर्ववृक्षाणाम् देवर्षीणाम् च नारदः गन्धर्वाणाम् चित्ररथः सिद्धानाम् कपिलो मुनिः उच्चैः शवसमश्वानाम् विद्धि माममृतोद्भवम् ऐरावतम् गजेन्द्राणाम् नराणाम् च नराधिपम् आयुधानामहम् वज्रम् धेनूनामस्मि कामधुक् व्रजनश्चास्मि गन्दर्पः सर्पाणामस्मि वासुकिः अनन्तश्चास्मि नागानाम् वरुणो यादसामहम् पितॄणामर्यमा चास्मि यमः संयमतामहम् प्रह्लादश्चास्मि दैत्यानाम् कालः कलयतामहम् मृगाणाम् च मृगेन्दुरोहम् वैनतेयश्च पक्षिणाम् पवनः पवतामस्मि रामशस्त्रभृतामहम् झषाणाम् मकरश्चास्मि स्रोतसामस्मि जाह्नवी सर्गाणामादिरन्तश्च मध्यम् चैवाहमर्जुन अध्यात्मविद्याविद्यानाम् वादः प्रवदतामहम् अक्षराणामकारोऽस्मि द्वन्द्वः सामासिकस्य च अहमेवाक्षयः कालः धाताहम् विश्वतोमुखः मृत्युः सर्वहरश्चाहम् उद्भवश्च भविष्यताम् कीर्तिश्रीर्वाच्च नारीणाम् स्मृतिर्मेधाधृतिः क्षमा बृहत्साम तथा साम्नाम् गायत्री छन्दसामहम् मासानाम् मार्गशीर्षोऽहम् ऋतूनाम् कुसुमाकरः द्यूतम् छलयतामस्मि तेजस्तेजस्विनामहम् जयोस्मि व्यवसायोस्मि सत्त्वं सत्त्ववतामहं वृष्टीनां वासुदेवोस्मि पांडवानां धनंजयः मुनीनामप्यहं व्यासः कवीनामुशना कविः दंडो दमयतामस्मि नीतिरस्मि जिगीषतां मौनं चैवास्मि गुह्यानां ज्ञानं ज्ञानवतामहं यच्चापि सर्वभूतानां बीजं तदहमर्जुन।
Let's take a look at the questions. You spoke of having direct experience through Buddhi Yoga. If this experience comes, will it be same for all or different depending on the devotee? Once this happens, will it last forever or the awakening of the dhi comes and goes? Last week you mentioned Karana forgetting everything at a crucial time. Spiritual experience is infinite. There are infinite number of ways the divine can manifest in our lives. So I hesitate to say the experience will be same for all. All that can be said with certainty is that when that experience comes, it will be the experience of the divine, but in what form and in what way and how long that experience itself will last, there is no fixed answer to that question. It can vary from person to person. Oftentimes, the experience itself will last for a relatively short time. But every experience leaves an impression in the mind. We already know that. It's a samskara. But the experience that is super conscious or experience that comes through this awakened buddhi leaves also an impression in the mind. And that impression, you could say, is a kind of a special kind of impression. So oftentimes it's given a name called prajna samskara, the samskara of that higher knowledge. So the spiritual experience itself can remain for a relatively short time, but this samskara is a deeper, stronger form of impression, will leave the memory of that experience. It's a little bit like, to give a rather ordinary example, when you drink a really good cup of coffee. Now, that experience of drinking coffee will last as long as that coffee is on your tongue. And once that cup of coffee is over, experience is over also. But the memory, how wonderful you felt, that memory of that experience, that's going to remain longer than just that cup of coffee. And of course, it's much, much more deeper and much, much more intense when a genuine spiritual experience occurs. I use the word genuine because sometimes we do get these kind of fleeting experiences in life, and sometimes we think, oh, that's a very spiritual experience I had. But then we find that that experience doesn't leave any deep impression on us. We find that that experience doesn't really change us in any significant way. In which case, it's not that helpful to try to think of that as some very profound experience. Because a genuine spiritual experience will leave us changed in some form. It may not be a kind of a very radical change, but it's a change that is permanent. It's a change that we will know deep. It's very difficult to explain in words, but inside we will know that something has irrevocably changed within us. So, awakening of the buddhi is permanent. It doesn't come and go. It may take time for it to happen, but once it happens, it remains. Now, Karna's example that I gave, that was not an example, that was just an example to show how in life sometimes when we need some knowledge, that is the time we forget, and that's the time we bring upon pain and suffering to ourselves. We are not talking about the dhi there. So it was not about Karna's spiritual knowledge that was being discussed, but it was Karna's knowledge of that astra, that brahmastra of the archery. That knowledge was something he forgot. Next question. Is enlightenment binary, or is it a gradual process? Initially a little bit and then more. You mentioned seeing God in one person and then gradually more and more people, hence the question. Again, I think it's difficult to answer this question. Does knowledge, once Sri Ramakrishna was asked that, does knowledge simply occur? Something similar to this question was this, that let's give an example. An example that Ramakrishna gave was that if the room is dark and you switch on the light, does the darkness disappear little by little, or there is light? So either there is darkness or there is light. You cannot have both. Light and darkness cannot coexist. So in that sense, you cannot say that enlightenment is a gradual process. So either you are enlightened or you are not enlightened. Clear. But when I said that if I'm able to see God in one place, it's not in the sense of some ultimate enlightenment, but if I'm able to feel the presence of God, let's say sometimes there are people who have made repeated pilgrimages to certain places of worship, certain shrines or certain cathedrals. If the reason is that, well, there may be a temple very close to their place, but when they go to that temple, they may not be able to feel that presence the way they might feel when they go to some specific place. And that place may be very far, maybe even difficult to reach. But people go to all that length, to all that trouble, because that is where they're able to feel the presence of God. So that's what I meant by saying that if I can have at least one place or one form, something, one thing in which I'm able to feel their presence, it generates hope in me. That it's not simply just a theory, it's not simply a matter of faith, that actually I am able to feel that presence in one place. And then, if I'm able to feel that presence in one place, and then continuing my practice of prayer and worship and meditation and studying books like the Gita, which says God is present not in one place, but God is present everywhere. So that kind of a practice then, even though in the beginning it may be directed to only one specific form or in one specific place, that purifies my heart further, then I'm able to see that light. The light that I was able to see only in one place, I'm able to see then in more and more places. So in that sense, yes, it begins with one place and then will expand into other. But that doesn't mean that you have gotten only partially enlightened, and then, I mean, you can use the term kind of partially enlightened, but what really means is that you are progressing on the path of realization. Sri Ramakrishna gives another example which may be helpful, and that is when the sun is about to rise early in the morning. Just before sunrise, you'll begin to see the eastern horizon. Sometimes beautiful, depending on the location of your home. If you have a clear view of the horizon, it can be amazing. The eastern horizon, it's kind of, you see the different hues of light. It will become orange and red, and as the sun kind of cups up above the horizon, it's absolutely beautiful. So even before the sun has actually come above the horizon, there is already some light. There are already signs
that the sun is about to rise. And enlightenment is a little bit like that. So if you kind of compare enlightenment to the rising of the sun comes full blown and is flooding the entire, at least, well, our part of the planet, flooding with light. But even before the sun comes up before the horizon, there are signs which show that the sun is about to rise. So you could say that if I'm able to feel and experience the presence of God in one being, in my Ishta, then that is a sign the eastern horizon is becoming orange and red, that the sun is coming to rise. And when the sun rises up fully, I'll be able to feel the presence of God in everywhere and in everyone. Next question. Along with moral behavior, elimination of desires is needed, isn't it, to realize God? Absolutely. But I think it's good to begin gradually, because the foundation, even before we start thinking about eliminating desires, why not start with having good desires? And the first desire would be, let me live according to dharma. I have a desire to live according to dharma. So elimination of desires will come later, but the first thing would be a desire to lead a good life and a desire to eliminate everything that will take me away from the life of dharma. So that would, then once I'm established in dharma, only then I can think of going beyond dharma. And that is the stage one can think about eliminating all desires. At that stage, even the desire for dharma has to be transcended. But first, it's good to have good desires. Next. You said that to purify buddhi, we have to be truthful. What exactly does it mean? Normally, we don't lie in our day-to-day transactional world. Does it refer to Brahman alone is real? Well, I'm intrigued by the word, normally we don't lie. Why normally? So there may be occasions when lying may seem like a harmless lie that people indulge into. And sometimes people who hold on to truthfulness say that even lying in a joke isn't the right thing to do. So yes, truthfulness as a practice occurs at many different levels. And the very first level is, of course, as they use the word, kayena manasa vacha. So the first thing would be then vacha. So now that's what we normally understand. When you say truthfulness means I must speak the truth. And I agree that most of us are good people. And we generally, unless there is some compelling reason to not tell the truth, most people speak the truth most of the time. And then the higher thing about truth is then not just speaking things exactly as they happen or reporting things exactly in the way they happen. That would be practice of truth through speech. But what would practice of truth through the mind mean? Thinking thoughts that are truthful. And that is where then this discernment of viveka will come. That is my mind thinking of only that which is true or that which is not true? That which is absolutely true and that which is only relatively true. But first, we have to begin with speaking truth through our words, through speech. Next is through the mind. And that's where then this discernment or viveka will come in. It is said in the Yoga Sutras, there is a sutra which says that when a person becomes established in the virtue of truthfulness, that person will become incapable of telling a lie. So once we become established in that virtue, even if you want to tell an untruth, you will not be able to do so.
Next question. In some ways, this goes in tandem with the earlier question. You mentioned seeing God a number of times. Is that indistinguishable from enlightenment? Or can those experiences exist independently? Now, I mean, the enlightenment is a kind of a very generic term that gets used in spiritual conversation. And it can mean different things to different people. When you use the word enlightenment to someone in the Buddhist tradition, they are very likely going to understand it in a very different way when that word is used in a bhakti or a devotional context, or in a non-dual and Advaita way, or in Christian theology. Now, it's not as if it will be radically or totally different, but there are going to be some different nuances added to that understanding of whatever enlightenment means. And so, again, seeing God, it's very difficult to kind of give a very definitive answer, recognizing that all of us have different ways of understanding and looking upon the divine. In general, I could say that in the scheme that we arrive at through the study of life and teachings of Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, and Swami Vivekananda, what they say is that seeing God with form, with qualities, may eventually evolve into seeing God as beyond form and beyond qualities. So these categories that we have, the divine with certain form or without form, a divine with qualities, without qualities, a divine in this way or that way, all these distinctions that are there in our mind about the divine, when we experience the presence of God without any of these distinctions, no differences of any kind, then that experience is often considered to be like the most supreme experience. The word that gets often used for that experience is nirvikalpa samadhi. Vikalpa means a distinction, difference. The prefix nir means no. So nirvikalpa, no difference, no distinction. So the experience of God without any distinction, and distinctions in terms of form, in name, quality, when all of these distinctions disappear, Vedanta sees that as the experience that transcends all experiences. But as I said, the word enlightenment can mean different things to different people. Next question. Is the part of you that remembers a dream your ego or the soul? First of all, yes, it's not. But again, if the word soul is meant the Atman, it's not the Atman. The Atman is just pure awareness. So all remembering, all memory is a function of the mind. So all remembering occurs in the mind. And it's that remembering is done by someone, that sense of I. So it is the ego in the mind that does all the remembering. So it's not the Atman. Likewise, when one is in samadhi and returns to the relative plane, is the ego that remembers the vision or the soul working through I? So whatever we experience in samadhi, again, just like the word enlightenment, the word samadhi is also a pretty generic term. And sometimes you will see, especially in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras and in other bhakti texts as well, they have like different categories. It really can get very complicated. This sometimes called savikalpa samadhi, nirvikalpa samadhi, savitarka samadhi, nirvitarka samadhi, and so on. The lots and lots of samadhis. So
In some of these samadhis in which one is experiencing the presence of God in a certain form and a certain name, that memory remains. That because a part of the mind also remains in that kind of samadhi. And therefore the memory of that experience also remains. So these some wonderful hymns and prayers and songs that these great mystics and saints have composed, they are not the product of their intellectualizing the process. It's not a product of just their literary skills. So oftentimes what they have described is what they have experienced. And therefore the compositions of many of these saints and mystics who have experienced the divine in samadhi, they are of special value because they are describing what they actually saw. But there are these, the samadhi that I spoke of earlier, the nirvikalpa samadhi, the samadhi where all distinctions go away. There even the mind isn't there. And therefore, when a person seems to emerge out of that samadhi, there isn't anything to report other than just this extreme bliss that you were in. So the example or the story that Sri Ramakrishna said kind of illustrates this point a little bit. He speaks about an enclosed space which has a fence, a wall around it. And everyone is there. And some people are trying to climb that wall. And not everyone succeeds in climbing that wall. But a few who do climb that wall see what is happening there and then kind of come down to tell other people what they saw. And there are some people who go up that wall to such a height, they see and they are so overwhelmed by what they have seen, they just jump on the other side and they can never come back to tell others what they have seen. But that's one kind of an illustration to know that some people who experience samadhi are able to describe what they have seen because a part of their mind did remain during that experience. But then there are certain stages, like the nirvikalpa samadhi, where the mind completely disappears, then therefore there is no memory of it other than just that you are a jivan mukta by then. So that's a general answer to that question. Next question. Chanting and bhajans often touch our spiritual hearts. Should we make a regular practice of chanting bhajans to help us see God? Absolutely. So if chanting the name of God, if singing the name of Lord makes it easier for us to connect with the divine, we absolutely should do it. And there are great lives of great saints who have realized God through this practice of singing and through practice of chanting. So whatever helps us remain connected with the divine, we should do it by all means. Next. If God is present in everything and everyone, is this really different than the ultimate reality, Brahman? Can you explain that a bit? No, it's not different. I'm using the word God, but at a more philosophical term would be Brahman. And that's exactly what the Upanishad says. Tat srishtva tadeva anupravishat. Having projected this world, the world was projected from that one infinite reality, Brahman, and that Brahman entered into every little entity. And so, in theistic terms, the word that gets more commonly used in conversations is God. That is why I was using the word God. But if you feel more comfortable using the word Brahman, that's perfectly fine. Next. Thinker is just a thought as much as the doer is. Once we realize this, I guess I, me, mine will vanish. Yes, I like the way it is put. It's like this. A thinker exists as long as there is something to think about. that exists. So if there is nothing to think about, then there is no thinker. It's like a king without a kingdom. If there is no kingdom, then this king is only in a name. You can no longer call that person a king. So similarly, if there is nothing to think about, then you can no longer call this person a thinker. Just like creator, God the creator. God became a creator only after this creation came about. Otherwise, creatorship of God is not an eternal label, because that would mean the creation is eternal. And if creation is eternal, that means God didn't create it. So that kind of a logical fallacy that comes into it. And similarly, therefore, I, me, and mine will vanish when you or this will vanish. So as long as there is a perception of anything other than me, and I'm aware of something other than me, I will remain. So for I to disappear, everything else should disappear as well, because the two are related. Finally, is the Jnana Yoga and Buddhi Yoga the same? I would hesitate to say they are one and the same. I already explained in what sense the word Buddhi Yoga is used. And there is a way in which the word Jnana Yoga is used. And then again, different people will use these terms in different ways. So there is clearly a lot of overlap between the two. But to say that one and the two are exactly the same, at least not in the way in which the Gita uses the word. Next, does Buddhi Yoga mentioned here have a different meaning than that in chapter 2? Again, it's a similar question to what we just saw. The word Buddhi comes, I think, in the second chapter as well. Again, Jnana Yoga, Buddhi Yoga, if you want to see it as just different ways of describing the same thing, that's fine. I mean, I don't have any dogmatic views either way. If you want to see a special sense in which the word Krishna uses the word Buddhi Yoga, that's fine as well. So I don't think it really matters much if you see these two as one or different. Next question. What else can we do in addition to the morning prayer before we start the day for awakening of spiritual power within? Well, morning prayer, if we have a spiritual practice given by our guru, then beginning the day with japa and meditation is also very helpful. So we come to the end of the questions for today. So if you get a chance, I would encourage you to read through chapter 10, even if you have read it before. And when we meet next week, next Sunday, we will look at some of the important themes that occur in chapter 11. It's one of the very interesting and fascinating chapters, because that's where Krishna gives that Vishwarupa Darshana, that cosmic vision of the divine to Arjuna. There is a lot to reflect on, a lot to discuss, so we will do that next Sunday. So we'll conclude with a prayer now. May the divine being, who is the Father in heaven of the Christians,
Holy One of the Jewish faith, Allah of the Muslims, Buddha of the Buddhists, Tao of the Taoists, Aura Mazda of the Zoroastrians, the Great Spirit of the Native Americans, and Brahman of the Hindus, lead us from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. May we be granted strength, freedom, and clear understanding. May we learn to see God in our own hearts and in everyone around us. May God bless us all and fill our hearts with gratitude, grace, and love. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Peace, peace, peace be unto.